I am so thankful and grateful that you guys are here today. Another day for us to gather and worship, another day for us to have an encounter with our God and Savior. So if you are worshiping with us online, please make sure that you go to our website, dobbinschurch.org, and complete the check-in card. If you are worshiping with us on Facebook, please leave a comment and like our page so you can continue to be connected with us throughout the week. Today I have one announcement. There's no announcements. Woohoo! So, if you want to know what's going on, or what's coming up in the future weeks, you can access our website, or you can open the electronic bulletin that is sent out every Sunday. So, thank you again for your support. Thank you so much for your ministry. Thank you so much for being committed to what we continue to do in this church. And how can you continue to be connected? And how can you be part of the blessings that God has given us and that we are giving to others? That is easy. You can go to the website and click on the give button, or you can leave your offerings and tithings on the offering plates that are next to the exit. That is the way that we are show our thankfulness to God for everything that we have received. But also, that is our way to continue to transform the world in Jesus' name. Amen? Amen. So let us start today with a word of prayer. Let us prepare our hearts and our minds. Let us prepare our spirit. Sometimes we come to the church like in the rush of getting ready, being here. Sometimes we have our minds tied up in what we are going to do when we get out of here. Sometimes we're thinking how long the pastor is going to take, for how long she's going to pray, for how long she's going to preach. But I want us today to put all that aside and say, God, I'm listening. Speak because I am listening. God, quiet all the other voices so I can hear you speaking to me. Speaking directly to me, to my life, to my heart. Gracious God, loving God, almighty God, how beautiful it is to be in your presence. The heavens declare your glory and the sky proclaim your handiwork. Your grace and love will flow, will overflow us, and will make our cup overflow, and you will provide to all our needs. Today we present our needs, O God, our situations, God, our petitions, our own selves to you, knowing that you are faithful, knowing that you are almighty, all powerful, and your power has no limits. There's nothing that you can't do, God, and we know that. But please, in your mercy, we ask you to open our hearts and minds so we can hear your words, words of encouragement, words of freedom, words of abundance, words for a better future, words of forgiveness and words of salvation, words of love and grace, as we pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Amen.
Put your hands together.
Brothers, sisters, come on down to that river. Guaranteed you'll never be the same. There's a fountain flowing from the heart of the Savior. Bring your sins and all your guilty stains. Let that river of life wash it all away. You've been searching, carrying burdens. You've been lost and looking for a home. You've been drifting, something is missing. You should know that you are not. No time to waste, open your heart, don't be afraid. Jump on in, the water is fine. Sailing in the river of life. Come as you are, no time to waste. Open your heart, don't be afraid. Jump on in, the water is fine. Sailing in the river of life.
Confidence, you've
there was no way, and I believe I see you do it again. And you move the mountains, and I believe I see you do it again. You made a way when there was no way, and I believe I see you do it again. Do it again. Your promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness. I'm still in your hands. This is my confidence. You've never failed me yet. No, no, never failed.
How many can say time and time again they've seen God turn an impossible situation around? And looking back on your life, you can see, even when you weren't aware of it when it first happened, He was with you. And He was already ahead of the problem. But every single one of us thinks that we can change things by worrying. We can't. But that's the way we're wired. He understands that. It's all good because He goes into battle before us.
Standing on this mountaintop, looking just how far we've come, knowing that for every step, You were with us. Kneeling on this battleground, seeing just how much You've done, knowing every victory was Your power in us. Scars and struggles on the way, but with joy our hearts can say, yes, our hearts can say. Never once did we ever walk alone. Never once did You leave us on our own. You are faithful, God, You are faithful.
Kneeling on this battleground, seeing just how much You've done, knowing every victory was Your power in us.
Scars and struggles on the way, but with joy our hearts can say, yes, our hearts can say. Never once did we ever walk alone. Never once did You leave us on our own. You are faithful, God, You are faithful. You are faithful, God, You are faithful.
Scars and struggles on the way, but with joy our hearts can say,
never once did we ever walk alone. Carried by Your constant grace, held within Your perfect peace. Never once did we ever walk alone. Did we ever walk alone? Never once did You leave us on our own. You are faithful, God, You
are faithful. You are faithful, God. You are faithful.
You are.
You are faithful, God. You are faithful. You are faithful, God. You are faithful.
Is from Matthew, chapter 6, verses 9 through 13. Pray like this: Our Father who is in heaven, uphold the holiness of your name. Bring in your kingdom so that your will is done on earth as it's done in heaven. Give us the bread we need for today. Forgive us for the ways we have wronged you, just as we also forgive those who have wronged us. And don't lead us into temptation, but rescue us from the evil one. May God bless the reading of his word.
Amen. And as we continue our sermon series, let us pray based on the Lord's Prayer. My hope is that that we continue to discover hidden truths. That ignite the power of this prayer in our lives. You see, sometimes it's like fire. It's like having like a fireplace, right? Sometimes it's burning for a while and it starts to dim, right? Start to kind of like go off a little, and then you put a couple of pieces of wood and then kind of like ignite again. And I think that this is what God wants us to do. He wants us to revisit this prayer that we know by heart, most of us, that we have prayed many, 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 many times in many different occasions. But now God wants to bring a new meaning. God wants us to go, and when we pray this prayer, to have the understanding and go like warriors and understand what really we are asking and unleashing when we pray this powerful prayer. And today I want us to concentrate on, give us this day our daily bread. You know, this portion of the prayer is a request for God to continue to provide food for us. For some of the, this prayer is more like a reminder of God's provision, but for others that don't have anything to eat literally, it's a plea for help. You see, here in New Jersey, about 800,000 people face food insecurity. 10% of the children in New Jersey are food insecure. 17.3 of kids in South Jersey face hunger. And this is just only here. You see, when we pray, give us this day our daily bread, it is not an individual request, but we are asking God to give us our daily bread. You see, the way that God answered this prayer is through us, the ones that are privileged enough to have some to eat so we can share with others that don't. And this is just plain and simple, right? We don't have to kind of like really go around it, because it's plain and simple. We, the kingdom builders, the ones who pray, "Thy kingdom come," are the ones that brings God's miracles of provision alive today. It's by you and me, it's by our generosity that this is happening. It's like when we did VBS, we were talking about this was the theme, give us this day our daily bread. But we cannot talk and say and teach kids about the daily bread and how God provides to our lives if we don't teach how to give. Because that is the way that God provides. And we collected tons of food and then we give it to the Beverly Meals of Love. And we are connected. We're connected because we're part of the same community, because we believe in the same God, and because that is what God has called us to do. Amen? Are we kingdom builders or not? Amen. We are. And this is not only something nice to do. You know, sometimes people say, because I'm Christian, I do nice things. You know, we do nice things because we're Christians. But this is a commitment. But a commitment that comes with a promise. Look what it says in Deuteronomy chapter 15, verses 10. God tells the Israelites, so be sure to give to the poor. Don't hesitate to give to them, because the Lord your God will bless you for doing this good thing. He will bless you in all your work and in everything you do. Do you hear that? Do you hear that? God will bless us in our work and in everything we do. But look what it says in Proverbs chapter 22, verses 9 says, those who are generous are blessed, for they share their bread with the poor. If you want to be blessed, share what you have. If you want to be blessed, if you want to receive, if you always want to have, if you want to be of the privileged ones, then give from what you have. You don't have to go and get anything. God has provided for you enough for you to be able to give to others. You know, some people sometimes say, hi, Pastor, I wish that I will make more money so I can give more money to the church. You know what? You don't have to make more money. God has provided you enough for you to live and for you to give to the church. For you to live and for you to help your neighbor. For you to live and for you to help out others that don't have. God has given you enough, because God is not a cheap God. We are, but he's not. He gives you from the abundance. He don't give you for the leftovers. God gives us from abundance, for a place of abundance, and we have not learned yet that. And we need to learn that we are coming from a place of abundance, and that's why we need to share. Some people don't share Jesus Christ because they think they only have a little, and if I give a little, then I have a little itty-bitty piece of Jesus Christ. No. God gives you in abundance. And the more you give, the more you will receive. The more you give, the more you will receive. And the more you give, the more comfortable you're going to feel giving. And the more you want to give, and the more you want to do. Why? Because you are going to start seeing how this works. Because you're going to start seeing this blessing. Because you're going to start seeing the faithfulness of this promise. That faithfulness that we was just thinking, singing about. So my friends, we are blessed to be a blessing. We are blessed to be a blessing. But now I want us to concentrate in one word. You see, we kind of like went over the obvious, right? And now we're going to go a little bit deeper in what this prayer means. And this word, in my opinion, it's a key for understanding the spiritual meaning of this portion of the Lord's Prayer. You see, then that word is daily. That's the word that we're going to concentrate now. Because most of you know that Jesus spoke in Aramaic, right? And the apostles needed to translate Jesus' teaching into Greek, because Greek was the universal language in the Roman Empire at that time. So the only problem with translations is that, and we were just talking about that, the only problem with translations is that sometimes there's no way to translate a word literally. You have to kind of like navigate around the meaning and around what you want to say so others can kind of like understand or get the idea of what you're trying to say. And this is what happened in this occasion. The Greek word for daily that it's found in the scripture in both Gospels, Matthew and Luke, is epousios. And epousios, it's interesting because part of this word is, well, first of all, it doesn't mean daily, like right off the bat. It doesn't mean that. But the first part of the root of the word epi means on, in, upon, or to. And usios means essence, being, or substance. You see, it doesn't mean daily. This is what it means. Now, when we pray this portion of the Lord's Prayer, we are praying for food, and we're also praying to be the answer to that prayer for others that are in need, right? But bread is both what we eat and what we need to exist or to be. You see, our daily bread may be better translated as the essential bread, or the bread that we need to survive, or better yet, The best translation that we could find was, give us this day the bread that we need to exist. How beautiful is that? Give us this day the bread that we need to exist. When we read and study the Bible, we found that bread is a metaphor for far more than just food. And I want to remind you the words of this portion of the scripture. Do you guys remember when Jesus was in the wilderness and the devil was tempting him? And the devil asked him to turn stones into bread? And Jesus responded, one does not live by bread alone, but by every word that comes from the mouth of God. You hear that? And then in John chapter 4, when the disciples, there is a time the disciples are kind of like, Jesus, you need to eat, you need to rest, right? And they're trying to push him to eat something. And then Jesus says to them, I have food to eat that you don't know about. And I'm pretty sure that the disciples were looking at one another like, what? We have been with him the whole time, right? And they even started, if you read the full chapter, they even started like asking, like, did somebody drop off something? The DoorDash came, and we didn't realize that Uber Eats showed up, right? And when Jesus, right, I imagine that when Jesus started listening what they were saying and started to kind of like looking at their faces, and they were like, what? Jesus then added, my food is to do the will of him who sent me and to complete his work. I'm going to say it again. My food is to do the will of him who sent me and to complete his work. Church, our food is to do the will of the Father. Our food is to do the will of God. And that is the very thing that we pray before praying this portion of the Lord's Prayer. Last week we talked about thy will be done. This is what we're saying. Thy will be done, because thy will is my food. Thy will is the bread that I need to exist. Amen? Are you guys getting this? I don't know. I'm so into this. I don't know if you guys are. You see, when Jesus asked us to pray the Epiusios bread, our essential, substantial bread, the bread that sustains our souls, that the bread that we need to survive, he was inviting the hungry to pray for physical food, for physical bread, and he was inviting those who have enough to pray so others can be provided and also to be part of that miracle. And he was teaching us to ask for and for us to receive the bread that satisfies our souls. You see, Jesus says, I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never go hungry, and whoever believes in me never be thirsty. See, I think that one of the reasons that Jesus included this in this prayer, this petition for food, this request, is because he really cares about our needs. You see, Jesus was a human like us. He felt everything we feel, hunger, thirst. He lived with us. He lived among his people. He walked in their shoes. He suffered like them. He fed thousands and healed many because he knew that there was no other way for them to have their pain ease or any way for them to supply to their own needs. He did it because he felt empathy and compassion, because he also experienced the same thing. We all need material things. And I know that sometimes some people take it kind of like a little far, but the reality is that we all need things. We all need a house and a car and jobs and clothing and shoes and guitars. I don't know. Well, I'm not going to judge because I just said shoes, so I'm yeah. You know, like, we need things, right? We need material things. And if you have a house, then you have furniture, and you have computers, and we all have cell phones, and we all need stuff. We all do. And also, we all need to have our emotional and physical needs met. We all need to be loved and love, and we all need to be free, and we all need to feel accomplished, and we all need to dream and to pursue our dreams, right? We all need that. And we also have spiritual needs, and we all need forgiveness and to forgive. And we all need salvation, even when you realize it or not. We all do. So it's okay to pray and to ask for things that you need. And don't worry about if you are asking for the right thing. Like, you know, because sometimes you think that you need something, but that's not what you really need. And you're praying and you're praying and you're praying for that something that you want. And it might not be what you really need. But you know what happened? When you continue to pray, God molds your prayer and your will to His will. And then when His will is done, your prayer is answered. Because now you are in tune with what the Holy Spirit wants for your life. You see, you have no idea like how many times I have come to the Lord with my laundry list. Because if you guys think that you guys, I don't know what you think about pastors, but sometimes people think that pastors have it easy. And sometimes people are like, hey, pastor, don't even work. You know, like, okay, that's fine. But you have no idea how many times I come to the Lord and I have so much to ask for. So much personal for all of you, for the church, for the ministry, for the community, you name it. So many things, and sometimes it's overwhelming, and sometimes it's just like a pressure on my shoulders, and I go and bow to my knees, and I start praying and asking God for this, and asking God for that, and asking God for this, and asking for God for that, and Jesus, I need this, and Jesus, I need that, and Jesus, I need this, and Jesus, I need that, and as I continue to pray, and the time continue to pass, and I continue to pray, and I continue to pray, and the Holy Spirit continue to talk to me, and the Holy Spirit continue to hold me, and the Holy Spirit continue to love me, and the Holy Spirit continue to talk to me, then I finish my prayer and I say, Jesus, I only need you. I only need you. If I don't get anything that I ask, I have everything I need because I have you. That is, my friends, what this prayer is all about. That is, we pray for food because we need it. We pray for food because we know that others also need it. We pray for food because we want to be reminded that God has provided us and that we have to provide to others. But this is also a reminder for us that the real food that we need to exist has been already provided for you and for me in Jesus Christ. If you have Jesus Christ, you have everything. You do. Once I heard somebody saying that there was people that were so poor that the only thing that they have was money. You can have everything in this world, but if you don't have Jesus, if you don't have the bread of life, if you don't bow on your knees or you sit down or you pray, however you pray, because I don't, like prayers, if you're in your knees or not, that doesn't make it more or better or more effective or less effective. But if you pray from your heart and you pray for this, This is what you're saying, people. This is what we're praying for. We are praying for the will of God to be done, because the will of God is our food. Because that is what we need to exist. Because forget about everything else. Because if we have Jesus in our lives, then nothing else matters. If we're fulfilling God's will in our lives, then the purpose of God for our lives is being fulfilled. And you're not going to need anything. And you're not going to want anything but more Jesus. You see, God providing Jesus for all our needs, physical, spiritual, emotional. God is our creator. You are important to God. God loves you so much that he sent Jesus to give himself for you and for me on the cross. Jesus is the bread that we need to exist, the bread that we need to survive, the bread that we need to be who we are called to be. In Jesus, we find the nourishment and the strength that we need to continue to fight our daily battles, to make God's name holy, to build God's kingdom here on earth, and to do the will of God. Amen.
This
lost without you. I'm desperate for you. I'm desperate for you. I'm lost without you.
Sometimes the presence of the Lord is so strong and so present, and you are reminded of everything that you used to be and where God hath placed you and where you are now. And it's just so powerful, so amazing. And then you want more and more and more and more and more of that, and your knees can take them. you can really resist it. That is the bread that Jesus offered. That is bread that Jesus wanted to share with others. The bread that we cannot get enough. The bread that is so good, so warm, so soft, so airy, so sweet, that we can stop eating it. That you feel full, but you still want more. Sometimes life is tough. Sometimes we get tired and weary for working for the Lord, for doing good things. And we need to be reminded. We need to be reminded that we need the bread of life to exist. That we cannot exist on our own. That the only reason that we are here is because of Jesus Christ and what he did for us. So this table is a representation of that. Christ, our Lord, invites us to his table, to all of us that love him, all of us who earnestly repent of their sin and seek to live in peace with God and one another. Therefore, let us confess our sins before God and one another by praying, Merciful God. Hear the good news. Christ died for us while we were yet sinners. That provides and proves God's love for us. In the name of Christ, we are forgiven. At the Last Supper, Jesus took physical bread and wine, and he offered them as a tangible means of receiving him. He used ordinary elements, things that they will do every day, they will eat every night, that maybe in every meal they will have bread. And Jesus took that, something that it was so common, to make his point, to make it an expression of Christ's presence and the life that he wishes for them and for us today, the way that he wanted to sustain us, to strengthen us, to nourish us. I was reading a book that it's called Lord Teach Us, and there was something about the Lord's about communion that I want to share with you. And the author wrote, when we want to meet God, we Christians do not go up to some high mountain, do not rummage around in our psyche, or do not hold hands, close our eyes, and sing Kumbaya. We gather and break bread in Jesus' name. That's where he has chosen to meet us. We meet Jesus at the table. Today, we are invited to meet Jesus, to eat the bread of life, to eat the bread that reminds us of the provision of God for our lives, the bread that reminds us that we need to help and provide for others, but also to remind us that he is the bread that we need to exist. On the night in which he gave himself for us, he took the bread, gave thanks to you, broke the bread, gave it to the disciples, and said, take, eat. This, it's my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. When the supper was over, he took the cup, gave thanks, give it to the disciples and says, drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, pour out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it and remember me. And now, God, pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on this gift of bread and fruit of the vine. Make the be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood and empowered by the gifts of the Spirit. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, showing forth the fruit of the Spirit until Christ come in his final victory and we feast at the heavens and heavenly banquet with him. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty God, now and forever. Amen. Amen. Now, as the band plays, Bill Pfeffer, can you help me with guiding people this way? Okay, so Bill is going to guide us today. And in the Methodist Church, the only requirement to take communion is that you believe that Jesus Christ is the bread that you need to exist. You don't have to be a member. There's no other requirement. The table was set by him, for him, for us. Amen?
Yeah. No.
Let us continue to be, praise God, praise God. Let us continue to be in meditation while the band take up communion. The body of Christ, given for you for the forgiveness of sins. Take the body of Christ given for you for the forgiveness of sins. So the body of Christ given for you for the forgiveness of sins. Jim, the body of Christ given for you for the forgiveness of sins. Oh God, thank you for the privilege, the undeserved privilege of partaking of this table, this banquet that you prepare for us by sending Jesus to redeem us. Thank you, God, because today we confess and we pray that Jesus is the bread that we need to survive. And once again, we ask you, give us this day our daily bread. Amen. And now go with the blessing of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, and the people of God say, amen, amen. See you next week here or online. Stay safe. Be blessed.
I love you, Lord. Oh, your mercy never fails me in all my days. I've been held in your hands. From the moment that I wake up till I lay my head, I will sing of the goodness of God. And all my life you have been faithful. And all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, I will sing of the goodness of God.
I love your voice. You have led darkest night, comes like no other. Known you as a father,
will sing of the goodness of God.
He's running after you.
And your goodness is running after. It's running after me. Your goodness is running after. It's running after me. With my life laid down, I'm surrendered now. I give you everything. Your goodness is running after. It's running after me.
Again.
Your goodness is running after. It's running after me.
Let me hear ya.
Your goodness is running after. It's running after me. With my life laid down, I'm surrendered now. I give you everything. Your goodness is running after. It's running after me
all my life.
All my life you have been faithful. In all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, I will sing of the goodness of God. All my life you have been faithful.
We got a hum.
All my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, I will sing of the goodness of God. I will sing of the goodness of God.
Okay, now everybody hum it. Ready? No, just kidding.